Yo, what's up? It's Nick Cannon, and when I'm in Charlotte, I'm watching the Chocolate Box.
Hello and welcome to this episode of The Chocolate Box. I am your host for the evening, Maiya, and I am seated here with some wonderful women in honor of March, Women's History Month. So we've got several veterans here, military veterans representing different branches, and I'd love for everyone to come and introduce yourselves to all of our wonderful viewers. Start with Chaplain.
I'll be glad to begin. I'm Barbara Summy Marshall, native of North Carolina, served 16 years as a Navy chaplain, both active and reserve duty, and currently still on the battlefield, offering transitional support and services and spiritual insight for women and men veterans. Very exciting work.
Thank you for your service, Chaplain. We're glad that you're here. We've got Air Force veteran here with us. Would you mind introducing yourself and maybe sharing your job and how many years you served?
All right. Hello, my name is Dari Mitchell. I did 4 years in the United States Air Force as a communications signals intelligence analyst.
Thank you for your service and welcome. Mm-hmm. We'll move on over to our Marine Corps veteran.
Thank you. My name is Talacia Cain. I am a 12-year United States Marine veteran, native of Charlotte, North Carolina. Thank you for having me.
Thank you for your service.
Thank you.
And last but certainly not least, we have our Army veteran over here.
Hello, Maiya Marshall. I served 4 life-changing years in the United States Army, combat engineer and logistics.
Thank you for your service, and we're glad you're here. Again, my name is Maiya. I did 5 years in active duty in the United States Navy, and I worked as a hospital corpsman. So your med-surg, I was in recovery room, just taking care of our veterans and their beneficiaries. So I'm glad to be here and share the stage with all of you this evening. So I've got a little bit of an icebreaker. Let's just see if we can warm up a little bit. I'm curious, in this Women's History Month, if anyone on the panel knows, when was the first woman allowed in the military? Do we know the year? Do we know the name?
1917.
That sounds awfully familiar.
Yeah, and she happened to be United States Navy.
All right.
Entered as the first enlisted member of all of the branches.
So, and I think the name was Loretta, is that right?
Loretta. Absolutely, Loretta Walsh.
Loretta Walsh. So let's remember that name and thank Miss Loretta for paving the way for us all. At what point in time, what year, was it passed that it was law that women could be in the military? Mm-hmm. 1948, it became law.
Okay.
And the Army was the first to bring in nurses into the military service. And so paved the way. Thank you, Army. Mm-hmm. So we've got a lot of history there within women, within several different branches of the military. We do not have the Coast Guard represented here this evening, but they are here in spirit, and we thank them for their contributions as well. So I'd love to learn a little bit more about each of you so our viewers can see maybe what life in the military might have been like for each of you. Who would like to share what their experience was like, maybe starting with what prompted you to join in the first place?
I think for me, the motivation came, I was actually at a turning point in terms of employment, had just given birth to a 7-pound baby girl named Maiya, and so it was time to look towards some other opportunities, and I went down and I talked with the recruiter, and that's where the journey began. He talked about some ways that I could offer service in the Navy, and so we got started. It was right here in Charlotte, in fact.
All right. So mm-hmm. a life change prompted your decision. You wanted to make a better life for your family, and you were open to seeing what it might take to do that.
Yes.
Thank you. And what about someone else? What prompted you to join?
I'll go. I left after high school, 6 months after high school, and I did not prepare to go to college. And I got out and I started working a retail job here in Charlotte. And I kind of started hanging out with some of the wrong people. 6 months later, I decided that that wasn't the path I wanted to take. And so I made a choice and I went down to Paris Island and I became a Marine, and it literally changed my life for the better. I was able to do that 12 years and then come back home and go to college after that. And, you know, just kind of set the bar for my children and be an example for them. So I'm grateful for that opportunity.
It sounds like you learned a lot during that pivotal time in your life.
I did. And I took on that challenge very early.
Yeah.
We didn't have much time to waste.
You're still growing up at that point in time, and I think it's fascinating. We all probably joined at different stages of life.
Yeah.
You had just become a mother, and you were fresh out of high school,
so
the path is open for people in different stages.
Yeah.
Who else would like to share?
I'll share. I joined, I'd say later, maybe around age 23. Very similar. I began school. But at that time, school wasn't for me. Did a little bit more hanging out than anything else, so I figured I needed to take charge of what I had going on. Decided to join, happy that I did, was able to come out and obtain my degree and to further my education.
So you made the most of the situation. Made a plan, figured out how could I get from point A to point B, and the military was that for you?
Yes.
And then for me, I went to school to be an art teacher, and I taught for a little bit, and I realized teaching was not for me, and I was just mostly curious about the military, I guess. I had family members who were in the military, not in the Air Force, but I wanted to see what kind of travel opportunities would open up. I just wanted to see what it would be like, so I did my 4 years, and then on the other side of that, I did use the military to go back to school and to travel more after that as well. And I also joined later in life. I was 25 when I joined.
You're 25, yeah. Mm-hmm. So I've heard travel, I've heard new opportunities, heard it, you know, getting out of a situation that maybe you knew wasn't best for you. So that seems to be a common theme, and the military posed, you know, this is a new way of life, yeah, transition. So what are some of the things that you learned while you were in that you still hold on to you today?
I think one of the things that I learned was the importance of having a supportive community. Yeah, just realizing how much people need people, no matter where they are, no matter where they're trying to go, but you need people that care about you and that have your back. And that was a lesson that I learned.
I would say adaptability overall, in different situations, around different people, around different environments, just being able to be aware of your environment and your surroundings and being able to adapt and adjust accordingly as needed.
Yeah. It's a life skill, being able to adapt and be flexible and take life as it comes.
I think for me, it gave me a lot of discipline.
Mm-hmm.
Showed me a lot of things. They actually helped me become the woman that I am.
Mm.
It helped me with my finances. It held me accountable. It required me and pushed me to go further. And so even in those core values, it taught me how to always tell the truth, to have good integrity. And, you know, those are the qualities that more people like really need.
Yeah.
And so I kind of still hold that as an example for others. At least I try to. And that's why I'm still so successful today, because I haven't let go of a lot of those things.
Yeah.
Some things you want to kind of stray away from because you don't have to do that anymore, because we're not in that lifestyle, that community. But a lot of that you do want to hold on to. Yeah. It'll get you further.
That's right. And values are foundational.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
You take that discipline, you take that motivation, that drive, and that carries you through other areas of life.
Yeah, and it does. It does.
Thank you.
And for me, kind of a combination of all life skills, discipline, the support system, because even on the civilian side, we need a piece of everything that we actually learned while we were in the service.
And speaking of all of that, I know today the pressure for young women is such that they've got social media telling them they should look like this, they should be like this, and, you know, conform to society's perception. The military asks you to conform in another way, though, doesn't it? So I'm curious, how did you handle that forcing, you know, to conform? Maybe you weren't used to it before, but you definitely have to in the military to shape up or ship out, as we said.
I think for me, like, it was kind of like you go into it knowing that you play the role. I had long hair. I had dreadlocks, locks. For people who don't know, those were considered not in regulation or unkempt or stylish, faddish. So I knew that I was going to have to cut my hair to join it, and I did it because I wanted to join. But then on the other side of that, I realized how much my personal autonomy and expression means to me, so much so that I knew I couldn't be in an environment that would restrict me from doing that. Like, I wouldn't be able to live out my full life potential, I suppose. But being in there for those 4 years, I had to present myself in a way that I would not have otherwise.
You've got to fit the mold while you're right. In uniformity is a big part of the military. Did anybody else have that similar experience or something different?
I did, especially joining at 23, 24. I was kind of already molded. I wore colored hair and had piercings and everything, so it was a little bit different joining, but overall, especially during basic training, just remembering what the ultimate goal was securing my future, so I didn't have a problem kind of drifting away, and then on the other end, I'm able to express myself.
We realize it's for a time, it's for a season, it's not forever, no one's changing who you are at your core, it's to do the job, and when you're done doing the job, you can go back to expressing yourself however you feel fit. Mm-hmm. What about you?
I'd say that adaptability piece comes into play. No one forces you to sign up for the military. We volunteer. So if you want to be a part of this gun club, then you adjust. That's it. If you don't want to be here, then there's the door, so to speak. So that's the mindset, you know, and if you want to be a part of an organization that is elite, is one of these, then you just adjust to that. And then when you get the opportunity to get out, then you can be yourself again. Yeah. So it's just a temporary sacrifice to get where you want to go. So if you think with that long-term goal in mind, then this is nothing.
And so you play the part for a while, and you use that to set the stage for the next step that you're going to take. And it sounds like all of you use the stage of the military to go on and do other things. Do you feel like the military prepared you for life as a civilian on the other side?
I think that was definitely a time of preparation. There are some experiences that the military just enhanced some things that I wasn't aware that existed in me, but some things that were really allowed to grow and to flourish as a result of serving in the military and being in the uniform and being prepared, being required to be at a certain place at a certain time in uniform. Yeah, it just taught you some things, brought you to a new sense of confidence.
Were there any fears that anyone had going into the military, knowing that you were going to change and life was going to be different?
I think it was daunting for me to know that you signed like a contract. Like, even if you didn't like it, you couldn't really just up and leave. I mean, I'm sure you could figure out a way, but like the fact that you have to like stick with your decision, like you made a heavy decision based on not having any prior experience, and now you have to live with that decision for your duration of time. And that was humbling, I suppose.
That's a good point.
I think we all might remember the very first day or very first night of boot camp, right? Thinking, what in the world did I do? What did I sign up for? Did anybody else have that experience?
Oh, yeah.
Or was
absolutely.
It just me?
Okay. Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
What did you do to tell yourself that, okay, I can do this? Was there anyone in particular in your division that helped you get through, or maybe a letter from home? What kept you going during those early months?
I used to count the training days, just knowing that the only way for me to get out of this space, this hellhole, is to graduate. Mm-hmm. So I counted down those days, and that means you really just gotta fall in line, do whatever it takes to get to the next week, the next evolution, and that's one more check in the box. Mm-hmm. And then finally, when you get that EGA for us in the Marine Corps, it's like the most proudest moment of it all. And it was like, you look back and it was like, okay, that was worth it.
Yeah.
I earned that.
I earned
that title.
Yeah.
So
I think what helped me get through was calls home, letters from home, just a reassurance that there are some people that are really proud of what you're doing and kept me marching. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Literally and figuratively kept you marching. What about you, Maiya?
Same, knowing that whenever we came towards the end of the day that I could expect a a piece of mail whenever everybody else was opening their mail, or on the weekend whenever we got to use our phone, that I would have somebody on the other line to answer, or I was going to receive a care package. Just those little things got me through.
Okay. So having that support, knowing that there's somebody at home rooting for you, you know, maybe praying for you, maybe sending you letters and cards, it makes a big difference. It makes a big difference. So how did you feel supported when you decided to join, when you shared your decision with your friends, your family? Was there anyone that said, no, don't do it, or tried to persuade you to do something else?
I wouldn't say anyone told me not to do it, but everyone else was just as shocked as I was that I decided to do it. And so I think that like pushed me to be like, well, what would I be like after this? Like you said, like the core of me is not going to change, but what does me in the military look like?
You were curious to see what was the transformation.
Yes.
Anybody else have any resistance?
Not for me.
No. Mm-mm.
I went willingly.
Mm-mm. Okay.
I was ready.
Like she said, ready for it.
It's time to go.
Time to get it done. time to be somebody different.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I remember being in boot camp and having different individuals from different stages of life. And, you know, one person in particular, the judge made them come. They were ordered to come. Otherwise, it was going to be behind bars. And someone else, they willingly came. They said they were eating out of the trash can just the day before. And so it was three meals. It was a roof over their head. So the military serves a purpose for different for different people and different seasons.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
On the other side of this, though, it sounds like we've done some amazing things as women, as veterans. I've heard a couple of you mention you went to school. Would you like to share what benefits that other people may not be aware of? What benefits have been afforded to you by your service?
For me, I used my GI Bill when I got out. I've purchased two homes using the VA loan. Because I'm 100% disabled veteran, my son gets to go to school for free here in the state of North Carolina. There are plenty of state benefits that I get military discounts all over. I ask all the time. There have been a tremendous amount that has changed my life. Life insurance, health care, to name a few.
Yeah, and that's a lot.
That's a lot. You have to maximize that benefit.
Yeah. Who else would like to share what the military maybe set them up to do on the outside?
Similar to what you said, the GI Bill, going to school after, the using the VA benefits, military discounts, all sorts of things, even things you don't expect. You're like, oh, okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. I think what's really important for me, though, is to reach those women, especially active and reserve, who aren't aware that those benefits are available, or who aren't taking advantage of the benefits. So I'm always on a crusade to meet women who have served and to talk to them about whether they are enrolled at a clinic, whether they are getting care and treatment at the VA hospitals and so forth. So I'm just real concerned about getting women connected to the service and treatment that they deserve and earned.
And they earned it. So why do you think more people, more women don't utilize the services or take advantage of the GI Bill, of the home loans, of the VA? What are some reasons that you've seen?
Some people don't want to identify as a veteran.
True.
Okay.
Some people feel like that I've heard that their situation is not as important as someone else's. So they'll want to give their benefit or relinquish theirs, and not understanding that it's really enough for everyone to benefit from those.
It is. It's for everyone. Yeah. Anyway, thank you so much. We're going to take a break. We're out of time right now. I will come back to you in a minute.
When I'm in Charlotte, I tune into the Chocolate Box. We back, revved up. Let's go.
No, I just want you to know that I really believe in you, you know?
Thank you. It's nice to hear that from someone.
These are cool. Did you, what did you?
Welcome home, man.
Welcome back. We're going to transition now, learning about license plates for women veterans. How do we let the city, how do we let people on the road know that we served? Chaplain, would you like to share some of the cool things that are going on?
I'd love to. I have a personal mantra, and it is a women's veterans license plate in every state.
I like it.
Yeah. I think every state in the union should honor and recognize the service of women veterans with your license plate. Currently, there are 20 states that recognize women veterans, and that includes the District of Columbia. But I think that we as America can do a lot better. But there's a lot of challenge and a lot of processes and a lot of monies that are necessary in order to move that forward. But I do think that that is something that needs to happen.
Okay. What do we need to do to get the word out?
Well, the very first thing is to ensure that, like I said, that women veterans who have served know that they are eligible for the license plate. And after signing up for treatment and care at the VA, there's a continuum. Once you get your services there at the VA, then you see that you're eligible for some of the other services, such as a women's license plate. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Are there certain North Carolina legislators that are on board with this and trying to push this through?
Yes, they are. Nasif Majid, and pardon me if I'm not pronouncing his name. Mm-hmm. Yeah, but a combat brother.
Okay.
Yeah, Vietnam era combat brother who is taking it on and who's putting forth Herculean effort to ensure that this plate gets printed and is available for the 90,000 women veterans in the state of North Carolina.
That's a lot of us.
North Carolina has like the sixth largest population of women veterans. Yeah.
I did not know that. Did anybody else know that?
I
learned something new today. Thank you.
Six and pressing forward, I should say. But it is time. In fact, it's overdue. And our mission is to ensure that women's veterans license plate is available for women.
Yeah, it's a representation, showing that we served on the road, wherever we go.
Yes.
Opens the door for a conversation to share about our experience in the military.
Yep.
We've got anything else you want to share about the license plate? Would somebody be able to lose that if they have a disabled veteran's plate? Or can you have both plates? How would that work?
Well, we're actually doing just a little bit of dialogue with the Department of Motor Vehicles. I've inquired about the possibility of having the insignia for handicap, but it doesn't seem like it's going to roll out immediately. But we're working on that. But I'm just trusting that if a woman veteran gets the plate, that they'll be able to buy some placards.
Okay.
Yeah, $5, $6, $7. Purchase a couple of placards. Yeah, put it on your rearview mirror and roll on.
I look forward to seeing that out there, and mm-hmm. I'll sign up for one, and I'm sure all of these wonderful women will as well.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to move ahead with a conversation that'll edit that about racism, and just wanted to cover that. Anybody have any experiences with racism in the military during active duty, and how did that shape your experience while serving?
I'd say maybe a combination of racism and sexism. Definitely having to prove myself, maybe being challenged with advances, unwanted sexual advances in order to move up in the ranks. Fortunately, I was able to overcome, but I also missed out on a few opportunities because mm-hmm. I was not willing to conform with the request. But all in all, as we stated, it made me the woman that I am today. So even on this end, I'm able to better handle those types of situations.
I'm glad you made it through. And though there were some challenges, you kept your goal in sight. And I know the military is not a safe place for everyone. And it sounds like we've all had some experiences and challenges, whether it's racism or sexism. It's present in the military, present outside of the military. So thank you all for continuing to serve in the ways that you serve our community and in our country. It's been wonderful having each of you on. Is there any last word that you would like to give to a future young woman that may be entering the military or thinking about it? Just maybe one, two words, sum up your experience and share with them. Like, even just do it or don't do it.
What would you say? Stay focused.
Stay focused.
Yeah. I'd like to just close with a reminder that just to be reminded of the women who died while serving on active duty and some even in the reserves. The license plate is being named for a 19-year-old woman who died at Fort Bliss during her first tour of duty. Wow. Yeah, Asia Marie Graham. Yep. Had reported to her command that she was facing military sexual assault. And supposedly the command listened but didn't necessarily take any steps to protect her, and then ultimately gave up her life.
Wow.
But there are other names. There's Lavina Johnson and Vanessa Gillian. Hatching, yeah. Yes, absolutely. There are many names. And then just recently at Fort Hood, Anna Fernando Bastila, can't remember her last name, Ruiz.
Okay.
Yeah, another young woman, 18, 19, 20 year olds, who reported military sexual assault, didn't receive the kind of support that they needed, and died while on active duty. And I think in a lot of ways that there's a sense of urgency about responding when a military member's report that they're facing sexual harassment or military sexual assault or military sexual trauma, that there's a need for a response.
There is an immediate response.
Immediate response.
Delay.
And not a delay, as you said.
That's right. Yes, let's remember those names and many others that were not reported, that people that suffered in silence, or, you know, maybe will take that to their grave and never share it with anyone.
Mm-hmm.
Definitely keep that on our hearts and our minds. That's all we have. Again, I'm your host, Maiya. This is The Chocolate Box. We have been celebrating Women's History Month this March and highlighting some of the amazing contributions these wonderful women in the military have had. Thank you all. Yeah.